This will be a change. Previous talks is mostly for experiment, and this is for computation. Also, I will really try to be general instead of dive into these specifics and the exact details. I will mostly introduce what we can do and what's the current capabilities. So give people a basic impression and understanding what's the capability right now. So why calculations and AP initial calculation in recent years really explode exponentially. And for example, last year, there are 10,000 papers using VAS for AP initial calculations. Also, if for example, for a person to do TEM and experiment, you can say seeing is believing. And for us to do calculation, we will say calculation is the understanding. As we know, in material science, there are three corners right now for such research. One is, of course, a synthesis. Another is the measurement and characterization. Another is the theory. And right now, theory, the majority of the so-called theory is really AB initial calculations. So what is the AB initial calculation? AB initial calculation means we do not use an experimental parameter. Basically, you give me the elements, what atoms, type of atoms in the material, how much, and maybe some rough idea, whether it's crystal or something, then we can calculate the property of the material. And then furthermore, for any the features for any particular applications. This including the features, including like electronic properties, optical properties, and mechanical property, and also chemical reaction, catalysis, essential. Actually, the law of material science is well known, it's over 80 years, and it's actually very simple. You can write it down in one line, the following line, is this many-body Schrodinger's equation. Unfortunately, because if you have n atoms, then you have n variables. Even to describing it require exponential amount of data and memories. So the computational complexity is exponential to the size. And it's very difficult to solve in this equation exactly. So most of the effort we have currently is to how to solve in this using approximate methods. For example, in recent years, well, recent means last 30 years, the prime driving force is the density functional theory, which making changing a many body equation roughly to a single particle equations. That's why we can solve in that. Maybe in the future in computer, in this quantum computing, one can solve in this quantum mechanics problem directly, then maybe by that day, we do not need to use the density functional theory, but that's still far away. So the development in the last 30 years in the AP initial material science simulation is driven by two things. As I say, one is the density functional theory is more mature. We know in what case it works, in what case it doesn't, it still has problems, and what different methods beyond density functional theory, like there's a GW method, a dynamic mean field theory, and all the other theories. And also, in terms of the computation-wise, the algorithm is more mature. We have made it more stable, and we are able to do a larger and larger systems. And also the wide acceptance in the research in the academic field. That's also very important. Right now, and as we know, in order to have a good research for material science, as I say, calculation is understanding, and it's very necessary to have some AB initial computation components in it. Another driving force is the rapid increase of computing power. And in the last 20 year or 30 year, the computer speed has increased 50,000 times. So that's pretty amazing. And I used to joke to say, if 30 years ago when I started my PhD, I submit a job which is not finished by now using those old computers 30 years ago, I can submit the same job in the modern computer. It will be finished within a few hours. So you can imagine with that speed, I mean, explosion of the power, it's not a wonder, I mean, not surprising. And we will also have a revolution in using such techniques in our research. So the challenge of ab initio calculation is accuracy first. And density functional theory, as I show here, is the LDA, GGA, and so we want to get in higher and higher accuracy. It's called like, you know, Jacobi's ladders. And another thing is the temporal scale. If we do a molecular dynamics, very often, and we can only simulate some like 10 or 100 picoseconds, but how do we do like seconds and to simulate systems which are real interest to experimental group for all for industry processes? Another thing is the size scale. So we want to do bigger and bigger system. So this talk, today I will actually concentrate and focus on the size scale. Another thing is the complexity. Material science is often filled with problems, and there are tons of possibility. For example, if you do catalysis, the reactant can be binding in different configuration, different size. So in that, we often need high throughput computations. So today I will focus on this size scale and linear scale methods. So the final goal will be like someday we will use the material science simulation will like today's engineer calculation, like a finite elements method to do the fluid dynamics. So we hope we can really design the material on the paper before we synthesize that in the laboratory. Why size matter? As I say, I will focus on this large size. Especially for nanoscale, nanoscience, nano means a few nanometer, not actually if you have a three dimension nanometer, few nanometer like quantum dot, that implies a few thousand to tens of thousands of atoms. And many physics like the defects, like the Morris pattern, and like the charge transfer, all involving systems which are relatively large. So it's like in 1980s or even early 90s, what we do is to calculate bunch of either molecules or crystals where just 10 atoms or 20 atoms will be enough. But if we push more and more to a realistic system, we find out we have to calculate those big systems. So all my message in this talk is say, with the big computer and with the advanced algorithm, right now we can, I will demonstrate to you, calculate like 10,000 atom systems using plane wave basis, really the standard AB initial, gold standard AB initial accuracy. So in the following, I will focus on a few examples where we have working on. One is the so-called charge patching method for nanostructure calculation. Another is this order n scaling, linear scaling three-dimensional fragment method. And also I will show you a few cases of like how we can even use in this for device simulations. All those calculations are using plane wave non-local slope potential in the accuracy of the density functional theory. So, charge patching method, what that is. Very often we have those nanostructure. And actually, although it size is large, and like a few thousand atoms, but if you zoom in or around each atom, it looks pretty much like a, you know, like in the crystal, or even if it's amorphous, it's a typical amorphous. It's not like you have a thousand atoms arranging completely randomly. Now that will be a nightmare. And that actually you cannot study getting anything out of that. So usually there's some regularity. We want to explore that regularity. The point is, under the density functional theory, all you need is the charge density for the whole system. Then the charge density, when you zoom in surround each atom, is not that much different from in the bulk. So you may wonder, why do I not using some small bulk calculation, get a charge density information, then transfer that information knowledge to the quantum dot. Then I get the quantum dot charge density. Then I can get its properties. So I don't need to do a full self-consistent DFT calculation, which is scale as the third power of the size of the system, which limit us to more or less about a few hundred or mostly a thousand atoms. So what we have is we have a method to do a small system. Then we get a charge density. We have a partition method to get a charge density which belong to each atom. We call it a charge motif. It's like the atomic charge, but embedded in the given binding environment. So we get that charge motif. Then for a given larger system, we put the charge motif back together. We call it patching. It's like you have your kitchen floor, the tile, you put the tile together, then you get a whole kitchen floor. So the same thing here, we get a whole charge density. Then from that, we can calculate its electronic structure. This can be really do for even a small like a workstation. You can do like 10,000 atom system, like I show you here. And this is the calculated density of state for these systems. And it's pretty accurate. So for example, for that, we can compare, for example, when the smaller system where we can do full DFT calculation. Here is the eigenenergy of this small silicon quantum dots, like 150 atoms. And the upper one is getting from the charge patching method and what I just described. And that lower one is the brute force direct self-consistent calculation. You can see their eigenenergies are very, very close. Arrow is only about like a few MeV. So you can really trust this methods. Another thing you might wonder is, oh, sure, you say I get the charge density, that I understand. Then how do you still get the electronic structure? So here, to solve in roughly the eigenenergy, and this is so-called Kong-Chien equation, to get an electronic structure is to solve in this equation. Mostly, previously, what we want to do in a straightforward way is, for example, we want to understand the optical property, which is controlled by a band gap and the eigenstate near the band gap. Okay, then previously you have to calculate all the state below the band gap. That means tens of thousands of eigenstate, not making the calculation expensive. Right now we have a method, we call it a folded spectrum method. We're changing this equation to another equation where using conjugate gradient method, we can calculate just a few states. Turns out those few states are the band edge state, like your conduction band edge state or valence band edge state. So you can get the optical property and many of the important electronic structure. We also have a method to calculate the whole density of the state using the so-called Monmouth method. So all this means there are some algorithm improvements. So all I want to show is using this method, you can really calculate like the quantum dot, the band gap of a quantum dot, and how it changed with the size of the quantum dot, which actually agree very well with the experiments. Here I just show you a few examples. There are many, many such quantum dots. So I actually consider this as a more or less a solved problem for the nanostructure, and you can calculate the excited state of the system and also the optical spectrum and compare to the optical spectrum. It can bring you a lot of understanding. For example, you can also do like this Kochel nanostructures, and you can say where the wave function localized and how different surface passivation might change in the internal electronic structure, where the electron, where is the hole. And you can, you know, this is just a beautiful picture of this Kochel nanostructure, and you can understand where this are the electron state and there's a hole states. And you can even do a really very large system of this Kochel and to say what's the effect, for example, due to this swing between cadmium, selenium, and cadmium sulfide, you have this swing. Then when your system becomes very, very large and the wave function are localized at different places, and there are actually some intriguing different phenomena experimentally they find out, but they did not understand until we did the calculation, we find out what is the reason. Okay, not only that, we can even calculate a way to understand the surface passivations. And like with the ligand, this is the cadmium selenide quantum dots. And this is not, this particular one is not a charge patching method, it's the straightforward DFT method. And to get to understand exactly how the ligand binding and passivating the surface of the quantum dots. So you can also using this to, for example, to study how the charge transfer from a given a quantum dot to the surface molecules and using macro theory. And another very recent example is now this Morris pattern becomes very popular. And again, so we studied this particular Morris pattern. Then one interesting thing is there is the ferroelectric layer of this indium 2 selenide 3. So you can switch, if you switch this ferroelectricity, it will change from one Morris pattern to another one. So this involving really 10,000 atoms, and without this charge patching method, it will be difficult to study. You can even use a charge patching method to study like organic systems. Okay. And like organic polymers, and even we did peptides, and where you know where each wave function localized, and if you do the dynamics of this, you can even understand how the what is the electron transfer in those big systems. So previously, I just talked about the charge patching method, which you get a motif and then you put them together, you get the whole system. But the one thing is that doesn't involve self-consistent calculation. It does not give you the atomic force. And sometimes if you apply an electric field, then you are not able to answer what's the screening of that. But yeah, anyway, so there's another method, which is a more brute force, but order n method. And where we can do a self-consistent calculation. So for example, if you have a huge, large quantum dot system, you can cut the system in space into with a grid into small pieces. Okay, so in the meanwhile, if you have a large computer, you can divide a computer into different CPU or GPU groups, and each group deal with a series of those small pieces, the fragment. One example of fragment is like next. This is the original system. Those are the fragments. So then you solve the fragment, each one of them. Then you use in the center part of the charge density. Then you use in that to patch together the original charge density for the whole system. The reason you can use a center part is this: those fragments are overlapping fragments. So you only need to use in the center part. Then after that, what important is you solve the Poisson equation, which is the Coulomb interaction from the whole system charge density. Why you want to do that? The thing is, we realize there are two interactions. One is the quantum mechanical effect, which actually, thank God, is a short range effect. So we can get from the small fragment calculation. Another is the long range effect, which is the electrostatic cooling interaction effect, which is a long range, but is a simple one, is the classical one. So, all you need is the charge density solve the Poisson equation. So we combine these two features. On the one hand, we divide the system into small pieces, solve the quantum mechanical effect on the small piece. Then on the global one, we solve the Poisson equation. And so this is the order n. And that will that helps a lot when you have a large system. Another thing is it has a double linear scaling, which means it scales linearly to the size of the system. It also scales linearly to the number of computer processors you use. So, right, if you have a bigger system, if you have a bigger machine, then the computer time you need to solve in this, the computational time to solving this problem is actually the same. This is very accurate. Right, left is this LS3DF order n method. The right is the direct DFT calculation. You can say they are more or less really the same one. We have using this for many different calculations. One example is the hybrid perovskite, which is a very popular material for like solar cell, a new material for solar cell. And we show that the wave function are localized due to the organic molecules orientation changes. Okay, there are 20,000 atoms in this system. But with 60,000 processors where we have, we have, and it takes less than 1 hour to calculate this system. The same thing is we have also calculated this Morris pattern and using this LS3DF. And not only that, for a large system, you can also get the force and the atomic force, which actually agree quite well with the direct calculation. So you can do molecular dynamics and atomic relaxation, which you cannot do by the charge patching method. Okay, lastly, let me spend a few minutes to talk about, I only have a few minutes left. We can use in this kind of things also to do like even simulate a device. For example, for a silicon device, we have this bulk silicon and silicon dioxide, and we have an interface because silicon dioxide is the insulating layer. And we can construct such a system, and we use an HSE, we get actually very good agreement for the band alignment of this system with the experiment. And with that, then we can simulate, for example, how an electron, if you have a defect state, like oxygen vacancy, how the electron transfer from the silicon part to the defect state, and how that transfer rate depend on the distance. Those are very important parameters to understand the device. So here, like say, we use a Markov theory to calculate that, and how this transfer rate decay as a function of the time. I mean, as a function of the distance. Another thing is we go ahead using LS3DF linear scaling method to simulate an actual CMOS device. So this is the silicon, and this is the silicon dioxide. This is the gold gate layer. The square, the grid you see is this LS3DF dividing grid. And as a matter of fact, each of the red one is like the one fragment. So you have many of such overlapping fragments, like those are the typical fragments. So you calculate that, as I say, patching together, you get a whole system. Not only that, here we actually have a very unique, not in strictly speaking, non-equilibrium system where you have the gate voltages. And so how do you calculate that? So you cannot using a uniform, a single Fermi energy to occupy all the states. We have a unique algorithm to study that. And to occupy the fragment wave function, and also to satisfy the Poisson equation for given boundary conditions of the voltages. So what you do is, on top of the usual plane wave DFT calculation, we also solve a cross-grain Poisson equation and to get the band alignment, I mean, the Fermi energy on the electrode. So this is a typical potentials, atomic potential crossing the line, which is this line, the dash line, on the channel level, and how the profile looks like. I actually, it's not very clear, but I have several colors which shows how when you have a different gate voltages, the potential profile changes. So on top of that, so we have a plane wave quantum transport calculation method to calculate the transport. I don't have time to talk about that, which is the different method compared to non-equilibrium Green's function. What we do is we can calculate directly the scattering state by solving some linear equations. So this is just some results. So that is what we calculated, and you also have the electrode and attached to it. And so those are the two like scattering state, example scattering states, how it transport from one side, from the right hand side to the left hand side. So we can analyze in this to say where the current is blocked and how, I mean, for example, if you have a defect and things like that, how that will affect your device performance. Okay. So conclusion is simple. With the help of a high performance computing power increase and advancing algorithm, now we can calculate system for 10,000 atoms or even bigger, which is using the plane wave basis, say, which is the most accurate basis, say, under the AB initial accuracy.